Debbie, how much of an actual physical turn-on is it to do that? To be feeling the music go through you, having the music all around you, and the people responding, which you do so wonderfully well. How much does it turn you on, actually?
Totally.
It's a total turn-on.
Yeah. What? I mean, it's the whole reason you do that. To actually, you know, do the performance, you know, have the song, write a song that means something, or, you know, that has part of you in it, and then to perform it.
Is it a sexual experience? I mean, you're having by yourself as you're performing.
It's not by yourself.
No, but I mean, well, obviously, if you're having it, you're connected with people, but it's
yeah. Well,
feels,
I mean, I've always said sex is everything. I mean,
you
know, you
and Freud.
People go crazy, you know, when you say that. You know, oh, sex is everything, but it really is in terms of just being plus or minus, or positive and negative, or opposites attracting, or some kind of magnetic thing, which is electricity, which is what electronic music is, and music is definitely an expression of sexuality.
So if you're on stage and you're working with Blondie, and it's really cooking, and it's as good as it ever gets, which mm-hmm. is many different things, one of which is, and the primary thing is sexual, and there's, say, 20,000 people or whatever, can you still come down and just say you and Chris be alone at 1 o'clock at night and get the same thrill? Or is it such a high in terms of the energy that you can't duplicate it in your own private life, that it just makes you want to be higher and higher, makes you want to stay up to that level?
I don't think there's any confusion about that as far as I'm concerned. Performing, I mean, we have a lot of different functions, you know, like performing and writing and watching TV and eating breakfast
function,
and
yeah.
stuff like that, you know. So it's all very different. It's all very separate. And it's like, I mean, you can't, no one confuses going to a ball game with watching television.
No,
you know? It's like different.
What I meant was, take the example of Elvis Presley, okay? Elvis Presley got into a routine where he was so powered up by the performances and by the adulation of everybody totally coming at him, and it was such a wired up experience for him that I think he kept trying to duplicate it. I mean, he got into taking a lot of speed, a lot of drugs, and it was difficult just for him to enjoy quiet times. That's really what I'm saying. Can you come off stage and have as sexy a time with just you and Chris as you have on stage when all this stuff is happening?
Oh, sure, because it's our secret personal thing.
Yeah.
You know, that no one else can know about, and it's even sexier because no one else knows about it.
How has it affected you that you look ravishingly beautiful? I mean, I know you're sick of these Marilyn Monroe comparisons, which came early in mm-hmm. your career, but you look ravishingly beautiful, and you also are an artist.
Thank you.
Except that it's true, and I see it. I mean, I feel it sitting here right next to you. I mean, it comes right out of you. Now, how do you feel about the fact that that's one thing, and that people don't usually associate that physical beauty with big talent? And in other words, to be taken seriously as an artist, has it been difficult and to be as attractive as you are at the same time?
It's not difficult for me. I mean, it's frustrating that that people don't expect that. I mean, for some reason, people expect beauty and talent in athletes.
They'll give it to an athlete. An athlete can be smart and talented.
It's more compatible for some reason, but as in performers and women, I guess, especially, they don't really correlate the two. But I guess men have as many problems in that area.
Yeah. So what have you tried to do to dispel it? Or do you just get annoyed about it or don't even worry about it anymore?
It's certainly not something to worry about.
Were you obsessed with being a singer? I mean, since you were a little kid? Wanting to be what you are now?
Yeah, I wanted to be a performer in some way, and music was always, I don't know, I just had a lot of feeling for music.
How did it start? Can you remember the first time you felt what it felt like to be a singer? The very first time? In Hawthorne, New Jersey, where you're from?
No, because I just always did it from when I was really little, and it was just a real unconscious thing, and I just did it.
As a natural thing, it just came out of you.
Yeah.
Did you used to stand in front of the mirror and lip sync to records and stuff?
No.
No? Did you used to walk around your bedroom pretending you were a singer?
I used to just sing a lot.
Yeah?
You know, I used to just walk around singing.
Who were some of the early people you listened to? That, almost like in a subconscious sense.
Patti Page.
Old Cape. Would you do two?
Kate Smith.
Would you do a little bit of Old Cape Cod?
Peggy Lee.
Remember Old Cape Cod?
No.
If you're fond of Sander.
Yeah, no, I can't sing it.
You don't do Patti Page material?
No. I used to listen to it. I think it probably had its effect on me as like being very singerly, you know.
To be a singer, yeah.
Singerly. And
how about who's the first rock and roll stuff that really got to Debbie?
First rock and roll stuff that really got to me was, I consider it rock and roll, probably wasn't, which was black church music on Sunday nights.
The root of all great music and so many unbelievable performers.
Yeah. But
where would you hear it on Sunday nights?
On the radio from Patterson. They used to have a little radio and I listened to that.
Yeah. Do you believe in reincarnation?
Yeah, I do.
What do you think you were in previous lives?
A lot of different things.
About the last one. The last one you... I read in a lot of places that you have been described as a reluctant sex symbol, that you didn't like being seen as a sex symbol. Why is that? What is it about it that makes you uncomfortable? You look very happy as a sex symbol, very secure, a little smile on your face.
It just seems very, you know, like it's like the 50s, and this is the 80s, I mean, you know.
Why, I mean, if it's there and people label you that way, right?
Labels are horrible.
It's the labels, right?
Yeah.
What other labels do you ever have in your life that you hated?
Oh, well, for a while I hated being a girl.
It's very difficult for me to understand why. Why? Who wanted you to be a boy?
Well, nobody wanted me to be a boy.
What did you like about being a girl?
There weren't as many possibilities at the time.
But, I mean, it still isn't as good as it should be, but it's better.
Yeah. No, now I love it. No complaints.
No complaints. No complaints from this end at all.
What's happening downstairs?
Oh, you know, there's a lot of boys and girls being, men and women, and stuff like that. Do you like to just go out and dance? I mean, it's so funny because people see you as somebody they dance to, they would get turned on, but do you like coming here to dance? Do you like to go out much? People think that you have a life that involves a tremendous amount of, you know, the common image would be drugs, sex, and rock and roll, you know? But this would be the image of somebody.
I don't know. I think that image is slowly fading. You know, I think the image of rock and roll is changing because, I've noticed that, like, rock and roll fans sort of have more diversified interests.
Than just straight rock and roll?
Yeah.
What for, like, the drugs, for example? I read that you were involved in heroin for a while, right?
Yeah.
How did that happen? And how long were you involved and how did you get off of it?
Well, I hate talking about it because it leads a lot of people in the wrong direction.
Not if you tell them that it's not good, it doesn't lead them in the wrong direction.
Well, it's a very complex problem. I think it's a political problem. I think it's a sociological problem.
Politically, that we get it in the country in the first place.
That it comes into the country in the first place and that, you know, kids seem to be the biggest victims of this. But yet everyone in our society is on some kind of prescriptive medicine or, you know, I mean, it's just, where does it end? Where does it start? Where does it end?
Yeah, but in terms of heroin, which is like there are 10 tons of heroin coming to the United States, like what you're talking about, I read this report, it's coming to the United States, and that translates into, that's pure heroin, 10 tons. Now, it's going to go someplace. It's going to go into people's bodies and so forth. The thing about heroin is, isn't it the one thing that you should never even do once? I mean, in terms of its effect on you?
No, I don't really think so. Well,
what happened with you when you got involved in it?
Well, I don't recommend that people do it. I certainly don't recommend that. But scientifically, I mean, it only has like a half-life of 6 hours in your body.
Yeah, but it is an addictive substance. I mean, it makes your body crave it and want to return to that point.
I think it is addictive in a sense, but I think that mentality is the commander of addiction.
And yeah, but what about all these people who want to shake it and they can't? I mean, then they go through these unbelievable withdrawal symptoms.
If they can't, it's because they don't want to.
Yeah, but what about babies who are born on heroin, right? I mean, there are babies who are born addicted who go through withdrawal, and it's not because their little minds are telling them.
Well, with physical withdrawal,
it's the smallest
part, I think.
It's the mental thing of...
Yeah.
See, actually, that's what I was getting to before, when I was saying about when you're on stage and when it is such an incredible high experience, right? Can you live a normal life with all of its lows and all the valleys and stuff like that?
Well, I think that that's part of what makes performers and like people that are supposedly creative or artistic what they are, because they do have tremendous mood changes and mood shifts.
Yeah.
And to be able to report these things to other people and to, you know, describe them as a painter would describe a very blue mood or a very violent something, you know. I mean, this is just part of what, you know, what our specialization is, you know.
Chris was supposed to be here tonight, but was sick. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, maybe it's nerves. You're trying to find a maid or a helper. See, but don't you understand that people think big rock and roll star, that's no problem. They don't give you credit for having everyday problems, right? But what are you looking for? What kind of person you need to help you?
Well, we need somebody who's efficient and sort of interested in. I mean, we have our own business, and you don't want to hype books and stuff on this show, but I mean, we just finished doing an album and we're writing a book, and
we
answer the phone all day, and we set up projects
that take us
all over the world.
I mean, all that's right, but you understand the reality. It's like if you're walking down the street, right? Or I read this story once where you were buying a bra in Macy's, right? And this girl comes running up to you and she couldn't believe that you were buying a bra. And like one would think, well, where are you supposed to get them? You have to buy them, right? People don't give big stars credit for what?
For buying bras.
Wearing them. No, but you know, for having normal problems.
I told
like
her I bought it because I had a burn one, you know, it's was symbolic.
No, you know what I mean. They see you walking down the street with their laundry, they want to know, you have laundry?
Oh, yeah. Do you know who Ugly George is?
Sure. He never forced you into a dark hallway.
No, of course not. But, like, I know, I've seen Ugly George around, and his show is, like, such a riot. So, I mean, he's becoming sort of this international phenomenon, you know, like, they're picking up on him all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
As they're picking up on a lot of the cable shows, you
That's
know,
right.
And they're broadcasting them in England, and they're putting them over in L.A. and so on and so forth. And I ran into him on the street the other day, and he just thought that he was, like, making all these remarks because I had a bag of groceries with me.
He didn't expect you to have groceries?
No, he was just like, that was like a big kick, you know. Here he was with a bag of onions in it.
Also, people say it's really hard to be successful.
Yeah, I did that. I did that
the last couple of years, you got tremendous pressures with being successful in a relationship. I mean, you live with Chris Stein, who's the writer, the lead guitarist. The fact you're so successful, it seems to me, would make you happier. But are there pressures that you feel that maybe get in the way of really just being intimate and being close?
Well, it's very time-consuming.
What, being successful?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, it's just like any other business, you know. I mean, we have a corporation and, you know, it's what it is, you know. Everything takes time. And when we first started living together, we had a lot of time just to relax and be with each other and sort of be very loose.
So now there's more and more pressures, right?
Yeah.
But at least if you travel the tour together, you're going to be together. I mean, it's not like you're going to be going in one direction and he's going to be going in another.
No.
Nothing like that. Does it drive the group Blondie crazy, that people think you are Blondie. You're Deborah Harry. I remember seeing a little button once that said, Blondie is a group.
Oh, yeah,
is that created a lot of friction?
It's always been sort of an insult to, various members of the band. That
the band is named Blondie, but you're the only blonde.
Yeah.
Isn't it sort of understandable that people think that? I mean,
yeah, it's perfectly understandable. But I mean, the fans love it. I mean, we have no problem about
anybody who knows music
Blondie
knows
is
that,
Blondie,
right?
And they know, you know, what it is. They know what it's about. I mean, it would be silly if everybody in the band bleached their hair, I think.
Well, that would be nuts.
Yeah.
You know, it's just Blondie is just a name.
Yeah.
So, what? I mean, but is it affecting the guys in a bad way at all, or?
No, I mean, it's like the same thing as saying, well, the success making you horrified or whatever,
not at
making
all.
Your life horrible.
It's just it can be an annoying thing.
Well, I mean, it started out as being that they were like, nobody wanted to sort of acknowledge who they were, but I think everyone acknowledges who everybody is now, so it's not so much of a problem.
How many different colors has your hair been? I mean, it's still there on top of your head. Did you once have blue hair?
Yeah, I've had every color.
How did it feel to be a blue head?
Great. Oh, very nice.
Yeah?
Really terrific.
And how long did you keep
very
it
very ethereal.
Blue?
Blue, yeah.
Was it dark blue or light blue?
Light blue.
How about pink?
Pink is sort of common these days.
Did you have a lot of pink hair?
Yeah, got that.
Green?
Green, yeah. Green was a mistake.
What went wrong?
Well, one was an alkaline and one was an acetic, and it turned green.
Oh, you didn't want it to be green?
No.
What were you going for?
Orange, I guess.
Orange?
Purple? Brown? I don't know.
Brown? No, forget. If it totally grew out, what color would it be? I mean, for all those who fantasize about being it, what color would your hair be?
This color here.
Oh, gee, I didn't notice that you're first. How often do you do it? Bleach your hair.
Not often enough.
No? But it's still there, right? After all those crazy colors?
Yeah.
How do your parents feel about your success? I mean, again, in the coming back to the world of rock and roll and late nights and drugs and stuff like that.
They're surprised. I think my mother, I talked to my mother once on the phone and she said, well, I didn't realize you were a star until I saw you on Rona Barrett, you know?
What did Rona ask you?
Rona didn't ask me anything. She just made a report, you know.
Oh, I got it. What happens if you go back to Hawthorne, New Jersey now?
I'm to see some old friends.
Do you go back often?
No.
Do they have a little Blondie Street in Hawthorne?
No.
Would you like that? They named a part of the city after, or a classroom? Where did you go to school there?
Hawthorne High School.
Yeah? Were you in a group then?
No, not in high school.
What about the Wind of the Willows?
I hung out with Brooks.
Did you? What about the Wind? You were never a groupie, though, were you?
No, not in the traditional sense.
Groupies
are the ultimate fans. I mean, they're it.
Yeah. Yeah, but you also think of groupies as throwing themselves sexually at the...
Yeah, but I mean, groupies are like geishas, too. I mean, you know, they'll do anything.
Anything for you at all. Do you have a lot of male groupies?
Oh, yeah.
And female groupies,
yeah.
Right? Anyway, what was the Wind and the Willow group, the group that you were with?
That was like folk rock group.
Did you play the guitar, or were you just...
No, I was just a singer, backup singer.
Can you see yourself being 45 years old and doing the same thing? That was a problem Presley had. He could never project himself into the future, unlike Sinatra, who has just totally done it his whole life.
I feel sort of bad about Elvis, because, he was sort of like the first big...
King of rock and roll.
You know.
Royalty.
And,
can you do it? Can you be? Can you see yourself being a middle-aged Blondie, 45, 48 years old, doing the same thing?
Must be. I think probably the only thing that made him self-destruct is because he was the first one.
What about you?
What about me? I can see myself doing music. I don't know. I don't know. Longevity is sort of. I've always felt that longevity was really. I'm